bless your holy name. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just bless your name, Lord God. We just thank you for the service. I thank you for your people that are here. I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your anointing, your burden removing, your destroying power to be here and to work in us and through us, Lord God. So we leave this place changed for your glory. We go from glory to glory. And I thank you for that, Father. I just yield myself as a vessel to you, that I would have a tongue of a ready writer, that I would speak the words that you prompt me to speak, Lord God. That you receive all the glory and honor and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, as you can see, I'm not Pastor John, but I'm going to fill in for him today. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So the part of that scripture that I want you to take note of is spirit, soul, and body. We are a spirit. We possess a soul. We live in the body. Amen?
Amen.
So the Apostle Paul, he makes it kind of clear. He puts spirit first. And I think that's interesting that he puts that first. I think he does it on purpose. I think he does this so that we can know and we can see ourselves as a spirit being first and foremost. Amen?
Yeah.
We are a spirit. I want you to go ahead and stand up. Stand up real quick. I'm going to have you do an exercise. If you're able to, stand up. I did this last time, and some of this is going to be reviewed from last time, and some of it is going to be building upon last time. It was about a year ago, last year, that I got to minister up here. And so I want you to put your hand right here in your middle, right? I want you to say, I am a spirit.
I'm a spirit.
Let's say it louder. I am a spirit.
I am a spirit.
Right. Okay, now I want you to put your hands on your head. I possess my soul.
I possess my soul.
Good. And then put your hand on your arm. I live in a body. Right. So spirit, soul, body. Amen? Oh, go ahead, you can sit down. Good job. So in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, I'm going to use the Amplified version. It says, this is Amplified Classic. There's actually two Amplified. It says, then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath or spirit of life. And man became a living being. Now some rabbis, some Jewish rabbis, say that that phrase, living being, actually means speaking spirit. We became a speaking spirit when God created us, which makes sense because we're created in the image of God, and God is a spirit. So we became speaking spirits. So our words are really important when what we speak. The second thing that I talked about last time is that God is a spirit and he made mankind for fellowship. You know, animals don't fellowship with God. They can have beautiful, unique colors and abilities, but they can't fellowship with God. They they can't connect with the Lord the way people can. So he made us the fellowship. Genesis chapter 3 talks about how God came down and he talked to Adam and Eve during the cool of the day. He spoke to them. He fellowshiped. He spent time with them. And it was kind of the way it sounds like he did this more than once. It wasn't just the first time. Because they hid from him. This was after they sinned. They hid from him. But the psalmist talks about how God thinks about mankind. He thinks about us. He thinks about how much he loves us. Now, we think differently than God a lot of times. A lot of times, we always think about the bad stuff, right? We always focus on, you know, all the things that we've done wrong or our past. But God thinks good things.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. He thinks about how much he loves us. He thinks about the good things. And I discussed that Jesus, when he was with the woman at the well, this is from John chapter 4, and I'm going to paraphrase, he told her, now he's not supposed to be talking to her, right? She's a heathen. She's a Samaritan. She's not a Jew. She's out in the middle of the day, and she's avoiding people because she's a sinful woman, right? But he goes and he talks to her anyways. And he said to her that God is a spirit and we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Because she was saying, well, you know, we worship God on this mountain, right? And you guys worship God, the Jews, you worship God in Jerusalem. And so Jesus said, no, there's going to be a day where we're going to worship him in spirit and in truth. And he's talking about the day of the church. He's talking about the here and the now, what we're living in now, the church age. And that's good because, you know, at one point, you had to be under the Jewish covenant to worship God, right? But now we can all worship the Lord when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. We can worship the Lord. And he's kind of alluding to the church age. And then the last thing I talked about Nicodemus. Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. Now Nicodemus had no idea what he was talking about. I don't know what you're talking about. How can you be born again once you're born? And he's trying to figure this out in his head. And the wheels are turning. What are you talking about? Jesus replies, he's speaking these very deep spiritual truths to him. Now we, as Christians, understand what being born again is, right? And after you've been born again, we understand these things. But he didn't. And in John chapter 3, Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life. But the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. That's good news. Amen?
Amen.
So don't be surprised when I say to you, you must be born again. And I discussed how all mankind sinned and how sin came about in Genesis chapter 3. If you haven't read that, I encourage you to read where the original fall happened. So when that happened and when humans sinned, we disconnected from God. When we couldn't connect, we became spiritually dead. And then sin nature was passed down through Adam. We lost our innocence. But when we're born again, we become a new creature in Christ Jesus. We become the righteousness of God in Christ. And that is so powerful. We get a new nature. We become a new person from the inside out. So we are a spirit being, and when we get born again, when we believe in our heart that Jesus died on the cross, we profess with our mouth that Jesus rose again, we can become a new creature, a new person from the inside out. The Holy Spirit, he'll come and then he resides on the inside of us. God himself will reside on the inside of each believer. Now, if you think about that and you stop, that is a phenomenal thing to think that the creator of the universe wants to live inside of you. He wants to connect with you so much. He was willing to send his son to die on the cross for you, to bring you back to him. So he can live inside you.
Yes.
Amen. That's good
Amen.
News.
Yes.
That's still, that always, like, it's beyond my comprehension. It's true. It's beyond our human intellect, right? Because it's a spiritual concept. Jesus was talking spiritual concepts. But even after I'm born again, I get the fact that he did these things for me. Why he would do these things? Well, because he's love.
Amen.
Amen. He's love.
Yes.
No greater love than no one to lay down his life.
Yeah.
And Jesus laid down his life for us when we were still his enemies. When we were far away from him. When we didn't have a covenant with him. Because he loves his creation. Thank you, Lord. He loves his creation so much. He loves his people. So the second part I want to transition is to our spirit. So we are a spirit, right? The second thing is we are a soul. I am a soul. And the reason I said I possess my soul, I'll get to that a little bit later, but what is your soul? Your soul is your mind, your will, your emotions, your intellect. Your thinking. Now you can have good thinking or bad thinking. You can have good thinking, you can have godly thinking or stinking thinking. Right? We can have godly thinking or stinking thinking. And I'm still getting rid of stinking thinking.
Amen.
But stinking thinking is no good. It hinders me. Our soul, it's not our brain. Because our brain is an organ. Right? That's part of us. That's going to, one day, if Jesus doesn't come and get us, we're going to be buried. And it's going to go into the ground with us, and it's going to decompose. But our brain is an organ that's part of our body. Our soul and our body should be yielded to the spirit man, and we should be led by the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
A lot of times people, they will mix up the spirit and the soul, and they'll kind of use the words interchangeably, but they're not the same thing. Okay? The Bible makes a distinction. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. Do we have your Bible? Go ahead and turn to Hebrews chapter 4. And I always encourage people, you know, if you have a Bible, if you have a regular Bible, I always try to use when I'm doing Bible study at the church or when I'm doing my Bible study or if I'm ministering, I'll use my paper Bible. But when I study at home, a lot of times I'll use my iPad or, you know, different technology. But I like the paper Bible at the church.
Yeah.
Because people can see what you're reading, right? They know that it's a real Bible. They know that it's the real deal. So Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and spirit. Say soul and spirit.
Soul and spirit.
Soul and spirit, and the joints and the marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So the word of God, it knows our motives. It can get to, you know, why we're doing what we're doing. Sometimes we do things for the wrong motives. So the word of God gets to those motives. It divides between the soul and the spirit. And you know, the thing about our soul is that we take it into eternity. There's a parable that Jesus talked about. I don't know if you've heard of it. And it's when Lazarus and the rich man, anybody hear about that one? Lazarus and the rich man?
Yeah.
And the rich man goes to Sheol, which is basically hell. And Lazarus, he's like a beggar, and he's very sick, and while he's on the earth, he sits at the gate, and the dogs lick his wounds, and he lives a miserable life, basically. And he ends up dying, too. They both die, and he goes to Abraham's bosom. And so when they're in there, the rich man says, you know, Abraham, send Lazarus. Now, he can't get across. There's a big gulf. He can't get across this big gulf. And he says, Abraham, send Lazarus to dip his finger in water. Just give me a drop of water, because I'm in torment. And Abraham says this. But Abraham said, son, remember. Say remember.
Remember.
Remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus' evil things. But now he is comforted, and you are tormented. So remember. He took his memories into eternity. Our soul and our memories are going to go to eternity. That's eternal. Our spirit and our soul are eternal. And I think that's why people get them mixed up a lot, and they get them, they interchange them. But the soul and the spirit are different. They're two different things. Even though they're all intertwined, they are two specifically different things. Now the third part of our nature is our mind. And that's kind of the easiest thing to detect. It's the easiest thing that we can see our body. We can feel. We can touch. We can taste. Everything's five sense realm. Everything's very out there and open. Right? We can get x-rays. We can get MRIs and ultrasounds done. When recently my daughter graduated from college. And we went to Virginia for her graduation, and we had to fly. So we're going through LAX, and how many of you love getting patted down and searched? Anybody?
Yeah, nobody.
No hands on that one. So we have to go through all the stuff. You got to take off your shoes and put them in a bin. You got to put all your stuff in the bin, and then you go in and you do that very invasive X-ray full body scan. You know. They can see your bones. They can see if you're carrying something underneath your clothing. They can tell by the x-rays. And it's very easy to see our body. It's very easy to touch those things. Right? There's scientists that are even studying to see whether they have special MRIs. They're called functioning MRIs to see when you're feeling something, when you're feeling a specific emotion, anger, or sadness, or joy. And so it's still kind of a new science, and it's a little bit controversial still, but they're using computer programs and MRIs to try to detect and try to figure out what emotion you're feeling. So you'll think of something happy or sad, or something that makes you angry, and a certain part of your brain lights up if you're happy. Another part of your brain lights up if you're sad. Another part of your brain lights up if you're angry. And so the soul and the body are working in conjunction. And they're intertwined. But we can't see the spirit with this technology. We still can't see our spirit. We can't see our inner man because it is a spirit. But we can see our bodies. And they're even trying to see your soul. And our spirit is not physically tangible. You know, it's not touching. You can't touch it, right? With our body and soul, we contact and operate in the sense realm. You know, sometimes our soul and our body are a little bit too in control. And so we have to be mindful about that because our body is the shell that houses the spirit and the soul. We want to yield our body and our soul to our spirit as Christians because that's important. Amen?
Yes.
It's important to be yielded to the Spirit of God. And when your spirit is yielded to the Spirit of God, it's important to yield your body and your soul to your spirit. Now, the next thing I wanted to talk about is feeding and exercising your spirit, your soul, and your body. We want to feed and exercise, right? And you know, we have responsibilities as people, you know, as citizens, we have responsibilities, right? You can't walk across the street and just jaywalk, right? That's illegal. You're not supposed to speed because there's certain laws and you can get a ticket for that. You're not supposed to, you know, do different things because we have laws in the natural, but we also have spiritual laws. And God, in His creation, in His wisdom, has given us responsibilities. We have a part and God has a part. We can't do God's part. We couldn't go die on a cross for our own sins.
Right.
He can't do our part. He won't do our part. He could do our part, but he won't do our part because he wants us to have some responsibility. He wants us to take responsibility. And so there are certain things that we need to do as Christians. We need to grow in the things of God. So what do? We feed and we exercise our spirit, our soul, and our body. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, this is out of the New Living, it says, physical training is good, but training for godliness is much better, promising benefits in this life and in the life to come. So exercise, and I'm going to talk about exercising your body first. feeding and exercising. So Timothy, Paul tells Timothy, Timothy's a young pastor, and Paul's talking to him. He says, you know, physical exercise is a good thing. It really is. It's helpful to you. Yeah. Right? But godly exercise is much better. So he's talking, and Paul is touching on the spirit, the soul, and the body. But let's talk about feeding and exercising our body. Now, most people, we know what we're supposed to do, right? We know that if we eat hot dogs and chips and pop every day for every single meal, it's going to go bad, right? It's going to go bad quickly. You're going to probably gain weight. You're going to probably develop some kind of brain cancers because, by the way, if you don't know, too many hot dogs are not good for your brain. And so, you know, too much sugar, too many carbs, all those things, we know, but those are bad, right? We're supposed to eat lean proteins and fruits and vegetables. We're supposed to eat good things. We know this. Whether we do it or not, that's a whole different story. But it's helpful to remember that we're a temple. We're the temple of the living God. Amen?
Yes.
Yeah. So we don't want to just eat all the unhealthy stuff. It's okay to have something unhealthy once in a while. You know, it's okay. We just gotta say, all right, that's not going to be the major portion of my diet. The major portion of my diet is going to be good food. It's going to be healthy food. And so that takes some discipline, right? That takes some exercise of restraint on our part. I like chocolate. If you know me, I like some chocolate, right? I don't just like any chocolate. I like dark chocolate.
Yes.
And yes.
Yes.
Yes. Dark chocolate. So I like dark chocolate. But if I eat dark chocolate all the time, and that's all I eat, you know, there's supposedly health benefits to it, but if that's all I eat, it's not going to be very healthy to me. My teeth are not going to like me. My waistline's not going to like me. My blood is not going to like me. You know, it's going to be bad. So I have to exercise my strength on that aspect, right? So also exercise. Everybody knows we need to do general exercise. That's just common sense. We need to do general exercise. And the Mayo Clinic says this. It says, so I looked up, how much exercise do you need? It says that you need to get at least 150 minutes of moderate aerobic activity or 75 minutes of vigorous aerobic activity a week, or a combination of moderate and vigorous activity. Also, you should do strength training exercise for all major muscle groups at least 2 times a week. So, we can look and go, okay, am I doing that? I know that when I was a teenager, I did more than that, you know? I tried to do, actually, when I looked this up, I was like, you know what, I think I'm kind of on target for that. I do work out twice a week, you know? I work out 5 days a week, but I do strength training twice a week, and I work out the other 3 days with cardio. And so, I was like, yeah, I think I do that pretty well. And we know in the natural that there's physical benefits of exercise. How many physical benefits of exercise? What are those things? Okay, we reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, weight, you have a better mood, and strengthen your bones and your muscles. And the best part about physical exercise, what is it? It's you get to live longer and stronger for the Lord. You can live longer and do more for God. When you're healthy and you're strong, you get to do more for the Lord. I had a friend of mine, and she was really pretty overweight, and she said during Hurricane Katrina, now she was a chronic dieter, and she tried really hard to lose weight in her own, you know, but then she'd get discouraged. But she remembers the day she was watching the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, and she looked and she said, you know, if I was there in that situation, in my current condition, I wouldn't be able to help. I wouldn't be able to help the people that needed help. And so as a pastor, and she's a pastor, and she has a missionary heart, and she decided that day, she made a decision. She made a quality decision. She said, you know what? God needs me to do his work. So I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to get in shape. And she lost like over 100 pounds. And she's still in really good shape. She still exercises. And she's focused more on the internal benefits of the exercise. And so that's one thing, you know. It's not just about the here and the now. It does profit you to live. but it also helps you to serve the Lord better. When I was 17, that was a few years ago. I won't tell you how long that was, but that was a few years ago. I was on the swim team. I was on the varsity swim team. I was a high school senior. And so I swim like 2 hours a day. And once swim season was over, and I decided to join the Marine Corps, I decided to join the track team so I could stay in shape for boot camp. And so I ran probably, you know, about 5 hours a week, an hour a day at least. And so I was in really good shape. You know, I was at the point where when we had, I was in what they call the DEP program, the delayed entry program. And we would have these gatherings, and there was one situation where they just told us, okay, you're gonna run, and I think we only did a mile and a half. I don't even think we were doing the 3 miles. And, you know, they were like, ready, set, go. And so all these guys took off, and they just took off in a shot, you know, and they're just running. And about 2 minutes later, they were like exhausted. Now, most of these guys, they're not in shape. They're smokers. They're out of shape, and they're just, who knows, maybe they had hangovers from the night before. I don't know. But I'm just running, I'm just chugging along, and I'm like the tortoise from the Tortoise and the Hare story. You guys know that one? You just keep going and going and going and going and going, and you just keep going and you don't stop. And so I'm on the track team, and I have this jacket that says Life in the Fast Lane, right? That's our team jacket. And I'm running past the guys, and I'm just running, just jogging, basically. And I'm going, and I finished, I think I was third out of everybody, and I think that, I don't know, there might have been two other females there that day, but I was third out of everybody.
Awesome.
Yeah, and so I just kept going, chugging along. So I remember one guy came up to me later, he was from a rival school, and we went to a track meet. He goes, I joined the track team because of you. He was going in the Marine Corps too, and I actually met him here one time in 29 Palms. But he goes, I just, because I couldn't handle it. You passed me up, and I couldn't handle it. But even though I was in such good shape as a 17-year-old, I can't carry that over, right? I can't bring that into the here and now. I still have to work out now. There's things I have to exercise now on a daily basis because I can't bring that over. So I have to take care of my body now so that I can do more for the Lord. Those benefits of endurance were good back then, but I got to do the things the here and now. We can't rely upon our past and what we did in the past to sustain us today. Amen?
Amen.
We got to do what we got to do today. So the next thing is feeding and exercising our soul. So our mind, our will, our emotions, our intellect. How do we feed and exercise our soul? Now, if you go on the internet and you look up stuff about feeding my soul, you're going to see a lot of weird stuff. You might see some good stuff, but you're going to see some spooky, kind of weird stuff, right? So, but these are mine. These are the things that I came up with. So first thing is that we want to challenge our mind. Be a lifelong learner. You know, after school, a lot of times when we're in school, we're in high school, we don't really like school, but once you're out of school, and it doesn't mean that you have to go to college, that might be a good thing, but find something you like and start learning about it. Start growing in it. Be a lifelong learner. Next thing is take some downtime for your emotions. You know, take a timeout. Take an emotional timeout. Sometimes our emotions need that downtime, especially if you have a type of work that's real stressful and you deal with like kids all day. Your daughter deals with kids. And, you might need some downtime. You know, get a hobby, take a hot bath. Hobbies are fun. Most of us, you know, when we get a hobby, it's just something, a passion that you have, and it's enjoyable. And it helps you with your emotional mindset when you get a hobby and you can just relax, right? Get a weekend getaway, go on a vacation. Vacations are fun. Once you're there, the getting there and the coming back, not so much, but once you're there and you get there and you relax, they're fun. It's fun to see different things, and you engage your soul, you engage your mind and your will and your emotions. You learn, I always learn things. When we go on vacation, when we went on vacation, my husband and I took a cruise to Alaska, And they have all these little things when you go on a cruise where you can pay for all these, they're really expensive, all these little getaways. You can go over to this and that and the other, and you know, go in a helicopter for $500 a person. Yeah, it's real. And you know, go on the glacier for a couple $100, whatever. But we decided one of the best things that we did on this vacation is we got off at one of the stops and we went to a local museum. It was like $5 each. And we went in there and we walked around and we learned about the local culture and the local history. And we stayed there for, you know, a couple hours and we just hung out and we enjoyed it, you know, and then we went shopping. Really inexpensive. So find things that you enjoy doing and engage in those things. They'll help you out, they'll refresh you a little bit. The most important thing about feeding your soul is to renew your mind. The Bible talks about renewing your mind in the Word of God. And it's really important. And if you're right, if you're taking notes, Romans chapter 12, verse 2, in Ephesians 5, 26, it talks about renewing your mind. We want to renew our mind because when we get born again, our mind is not born again. Our thinking doesn't change instantly when you're born again. You've got to renew your mind to the Word of God to start thinking like God thinks. The things you can think, like Dr. Seuss. But the things God thinks, that's what we want. We want the things that God thinks. Now, exercising your soul. One of the things as far as exercising your soul is operating in self-control. Say, operating in self-control.
Operating in self-control.
Yeah. That's not always fun. But that, remember when I was talking about possessing your soul? That's operating in self-control. Sometimes our soul tries to take a detour. And we go off on little detours. I know if you're like me, I have to be very mindful to operate in self-control. Reel in my thoughts. The Bible talks about casting down every thought and imagination that exalts itself against the knowledge of Christ. I have to reel in my thoughts because my thoughts get away from me sometimes. Especially if you're like, you know, somebody says something to you or they're rude to you or they cut you off in traffic, right? That is a really good opportunity to exercise self-control.
Yeah.
if you're the type of person, you know, you got a little road rage, you can operate in self-control. It's a good time for exercising your soul. One of the best ways to tackle, you know, issues. Last week we had a teen challenge here, and they were talking about all the things that they went through in their testimonies, and they were great testimonies. And I love Teen Challenge because it talks about the spirit, the soul, and the body, that it engages all of these things to get people delivered. Because if you don't engage all those things, you're going to have triggers in other areas, right? So most of these people, they try to do it on their own, but then they had a trigger. Something triggered them. And then a lot of times they went off. You know, Celebrate Recovery does the same thing. It engages your spirit, your soul, and your body, right? So one of the best things to tackle issues dealing with your soul and with your body is fasting. It's a good way to exercise is fasting. Because fasting doesn't change God, right? Fasting and prayer, right? But it gets our body, it tells our body and our soul that you're not in control. You're not in charge of me. My spirit's in charge of me. And so when we fast, when we pray, and it doesn't have to be a long fast. It could be, you know, maybe you're fasting from something specific. Maybe there's something that has just a little bit too much control over you. You know, maybe you watch too much TV or you're on the computer too much. Maybe you're on that Facebook too much. Then I have friends all the time. I'll hear people say, I'm going to come off Facebook for a while. And it's helpful because you're fasting from Facebook. It's not necessarily food, but whatever that thing is that's trying to control you. So you do that fasting. That's really helpful. It helps get things and tells you that your spirit is in control. Especially if you do fasting and you're praying and fasting. You know, fasting in and of itself is good, and it's good for your body and it's good for your soul. But if you're praying and you're fasting, you're seeking the Lord while you're fasting, these things change you. They make a permanent change. They'll make an eternal change in your life. Now, let's talk about exercising your spirit. And we talked a little bit about it, but the first thing you got to do to exercise your spirit is to get born again, right? Jesus said, you must be born again to see the kingdom of God. We're not going to be able to see anything in the kingdom and understand the things of God unless we're born again. So we have to believe the love that God has for us.
Amen.
Amen. A lot of Christians, we know that God loves us. We know that God is love. But we don't always believe the love that God has for us. Mm-hmm. Down deep in our heart, we don't always believe the love. So going beyond the born-again experience and believing the love that God has for us, believing the things that God says about us, and then walking those things out. Another thing is prayer. Now, prayer can be feeding or it can be exercising. Now, what do I mean by that? Prayer can be exercising if, for example, you're praying for somebody else. You're interceding for somebody. You're praying to change a situation, right? That doesn't concern you. You can be exercising. But in Jude chapter 1, verse 20, this can be a feeding type of prayer. It says, but you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Say, building yourself up.
Building yourself up.
So we can build ourselves up by praying in the Holy Spirit. That's talking about praying in tongues, like on the day of Pentecost in the book of Acts. When we pray in tongues for personal edification, we're building ourselves up. And there's different functions of tongues. I don't really have time to go into it right now. But we're praying in tongues to build ourselves up. We're feeding our spirit when we do that. Now, if you ask if you're praying in and maybe you are in a service, and you can do this at home too, when you're praying in tongues and you ask God for the interpretation, then you would be exercising your spirit as well. So we can also build ourselves up, praying in tongues, building our most holy faith, and we can exercise by praying for other people in other situations and interceding. Amen. And then walking in God's love. Now, walking in God's love, we've got to remember we've got to walk in God's love towards ourselves too. First, really, because if we don't walk in God's love towards ourselves first, we can't love other people. A lot of times people have a hard time dealing with others because they haven't dealt with themselves. They haven't dealt with the hurts in the past. And so submitting those things to the Lord, believing the love that God has for you, and submitting yourself, loving yourself and others, learning to respond instead of react. That, for me, that's not always easy. That is a challenge for me sometimes, responding, not reacting. When someone says something or does something, pull back, whoa, you know. I have to learn to respond instead of react. Walking in God's love, exercising, forgiving ourselves. You know, forgiving yourself is not always easy. It's really easy for the enemy to take you back to your past. And that's where the soul, when we renew our mind, that's where that comes into play. But forgiving yourself, and then you can forgive others. If you can't learn to forgive yourself, it's really hard to forgive other people. So we've got to forgive ourselves. We can't receive forgiveness unless we make the decision to forgive others. Jesus said that. He said, you know, the Father won't forgive you unless you forgive others. And so we've got to learn to forgive ourselves, receive the love, believe the love that God has for us, and then learn to forgive others. And then learning to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. So once we're born again, and the Spirit of God comes and lives on the inside of us, He's in us, right? But He wants to lead us and guide us. That's not the end of the story. Just getting born again, that's the first step. That's the beginning of your spiritual walk. We've got to learn how to be led by the Spirit of God. Learn how to hear His voice. Moms can always hear their own kid. How many of you have ever experienced that as a mom, right? And if you have a child, you can hear your kid over any other kid on the playground or over any other kid in the nursery. You're like, all the kids start crying and you perk up your ears. Oh, nope, that's not mine. But if it's yours, you know it's yours, and you go running to your own kids. So we can learn to hear the Spirit's voice, the Holy Spirit's voice. We train ourselves to hear the Spirit's voice. And that takes time. That takes experience. It takes time in God's presence. Your kids know mom's voice because they're spent time with her. I have a friend in my homeschool group, and she whistles. She has this really high-pitched whistle. And she does this whistle, and it's kind of like a dog whistle. Nobody can hear it but her kids. And her kids stop, and then they're like, oh, mom's whistling, it's time to go. Because if she whistles, that means we're leaving now. Let's go. I'm going to leave you behind if you don't get in this car right now. So learning to hear the Spirit's call, the Spirit's voice. He lives, and he speaks, and he leads, and he guides. So we've got to learn to be led by the Spirit of God. And then worship. We worship this morning. One of the ways to exercise your spirit is to worship God. And you can worship God at home. I love YouTube because I can put on any kind of worship song I want. Oh, I want that one right now. I want this one. You know, I want this one right now. And you can worship at home. I encourage you to do that. Worship at home. So when you come here, you're ready to worship. You're ready to join in. You can worship at home individually. You can worship corporately. And it helps feed your spirit. And then, at the same time, you're giving God glory. That's a win-win, right? That's a win-win. You get to worship God and get fed, but then you get to exercise and worship the Lord. So it's actually both. Amen. So what are the takeaways? I am a spirit, I possess my soul, and I live in a body. Threefold being. We are a threefold being. We need to feed and exercise our bodies. When we feed and exercise our bodies, we can live long and live strong for the Lord. We can do more for God when we feed and exercise our bodies. If we're thinking about looking at the end goal, looking at Jesus, keeping our eyes on Jesus, just like Peter, when he looked at the waves, what did he do? He fell, and he fell in the water. But when he looked at Jesus, he focused, he succeeded, right? As long as he was looking at Jesus. So we want to focus on the Lord. Why do we exercise? We don't want to get out of bed. We exercise because we can live long and strong for the Lord. Feeding and exercising our soul, renewing our mind, building ourselves up, becoming lifelong learners. We build our willpower when we do that, when we feed our soul. And feeding and exercising our spirit, getting born again, praying in the Spirit, praying and interceding for people. Builds faith to do the work of the ministry and to live a victorious Christian life. We want to feed ourselves spirit, soul, and body. We want to exercise spirit, soul, and body. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So my encouragement to you this week is to feed yourself. Feed yourself spiritually. And I always like to say spirit, soul, and body because that's what Paul said. Feed yourself spiritually. Feed your soul with good things. Too much junk food in any area is not good. Right? And feed your body. Good things. Amen? Exercise your spirit. Exercise your soul. Exercise your body. Because we want to do the work of the ministry. Just because you're not up here doesn't mean that God doesn't have something for you to do. We all have a part. We all have something to do for the Lord. And so I just want to encourage you to do that this week. And we're going to close in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this day, and I thank you for your people. I thank you that your word does not return void. I thank you, Father God, for the words that have come out of me that are inspired by your Spirit. I thank you that your Holy Spirit is going to minister to your people this week and bring the things up, the things